الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن الله سبحانه وتعالى خلق الخلق وهو العالم سبحانه وتعالى بما يصلحهم، وهو العالم سبحانه وتعالى بما يصلحهم، كما قال سبحانه: ألا يعلم من خلق وهو اللطيف الخبير. وقد جاء في الحديث الصحيح عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال: تركت فيكم أمرين لن تضلوا ما تمسكتم بهما، كتاب الله وسنتي. والتمسك بالكتاب والسنة من أسباب العز والتمكين، كما قال الله سبحانه وتعالى: وجعلنا منهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا لما صبروا وكانوا بآياتنا يوقنون. وبالصبر واليقين تنال الإمامة في الدين، فهذا موعود الله عز وجل لمن تمسك بكتابه أن يهديه سبل الرشاد. ألف لام ميم: ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. والسنة أيضا هدى، ومن تمسك بها أداه الله سبحانه. وفي هذه الليلة المباركة، هذه التي هي ليلة الاثنين الخامس من ربيع الأول من سنة 35 و400 ألف لهجرة المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم، في هذا المسجد المبارك، في مسجد التوحيد في هذه المدينة، الذي هو من أوائل، بل لعله هو أول المساجد نشرا لسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما يحبها الله سبحانه وتعالى ويرضاها، وكما بلغها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لأمته ورضيها صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإننا في هذه الليلة نسعد بكلام الله وكلام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، الذي لا خير ولا هدى ولا توفيق ولا صلاح ولا من أسباب السعادة إلا بهما. نسأل الله عز وجل أن نكون من هذا شأنه. والموضوع كما ذكر الإخوة هو وقفات يسيرة مع حديث حذيفة ابن اليمان في فتن آخر الزمان. نسأل الله عز وجل أن يعيدنا وإياكم من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن.
Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we praise Him. We ask for His peace and blessings to be bestowed upon the seal of the Prophethood Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household and his companions, and those who follow upon righteousness at the day of judgment. Shaykh Abi Abdullah Abdurrahman Umaysan began with thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praising Him, bearing witness there is nothing worthy of worship except Allah and that Muhammad is a servant and messenger, and said to proceed: for indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the creation, and He knows that in which rectifies them and brings them to a state of betterment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and what it means, is it He that does not know, and He is the one who created, and He is the creator, and He is the all-knowing, the all-compassionate. He was mentioned in the hadith, which is authentic and sahih. The Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I left you two matters that you can never go astray if you hold fast to them. The words of Allah, I mean the book of Allah, and the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, my sunnah and my way. So holding on to the Qur'an and the Sunnah, it is from the means in which one can attain honor and glory and success, and is the only way of salvation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us what it means. We made from you leaders, those who follow in the guidance of that in which we have legislated, and they were firm believers in our signs, in our revelations, in our words, and were certain and were sure in their belief in them. And as it was mentioned by the Salaf and the righteous predecessor that they said, or that one of them said, that with patience and certainty and steadfastness, individual will attain leadership, authority, and superiority and steadfastness pertaining to their religion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in His words, Alif Lam Mim, indeed, this is the book in which there is no doubt is a guidance for the righteous and the pious. And the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his authentic tradition, likewise, is a form of enlightenment and guidance. Whoever holds fast to it is guided. And this blessed night, Monday night, the 5th of Rabi' al-Awwal, from the 1435th year from the migration of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Afwan. Naam. Naam. This is the night of the 5th. It's the night the eve of the 5th of Rabi al-Awwal, 1000th year, 435th year after the migration of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we come together with our brethren in faith, Masjid al-Tawheed, in this blessed place, in which it was from the forerunners in the forefront, maybe the first masjid in this area, in which propagated, spread the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, established it throughout the community, in the society, that in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approves of, the way and the manner and mannerism in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approves of and likes. And it was, as it was mentioned by the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and here we are happy to be among those who share this and are a part of this and who go in accordance with this. The words of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which there is no good, there's no guidance whatsoever, no enlightenment, except with them, through them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us and you from those who follow in accordance with the words of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by the permission of Allah, we will talk about, as it was mentioned to you, or as you all know, subject matter of some points, some benefits pertaining to the hadith of Hudhayfa in the times of trials and tribulations at the end of times.
نذكر بإذن الله حديث حذيفة ابن اليمان رضي الله عنهما ونذكر بعض الوقفات والدروس المستفادة منه على سبيل العجالة لأن الوقت لا يتسع للكلام عن كل مسألة مسترسلة. جاء عند الإمام البخاري ومسلم في صحيحيهما عن أبي نجيد حذيفة بن اليمان رضي الله عنهما قال كان الناس يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يدركني ثم قال يا رسول الله إنا كنا في جاهلية وشر قال يا رسول الله إنا كنا في جاهلية وشر فجاءنا الله بهذا الخير فهل بعد هذا الخير من شر قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال نعم قلت فهل بعد ذلك الشر من خير قال نعم قال قلت فهل بعد ذلك الشر من خير قال نعم قلت هذا الخير من الشر أو ما هو الخير من الشر يا رسول الله قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قوم يهدون بغير هدي تعرف منهم وتنكر قال قلت عن حذيفة بن اليمان رضي الله عنهما قال كان الناس يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يدركني فقلت يا رسول الله إنا كنا في جاهلية وشر فجاءنا الله بهذا الخير فهل بعد هذا الخير من شر قال نعم قلت فهل بعد ذلك الشر من خير قال نعم وفيه دخن قلت وما دخنه قال قوم يستنون بغير سنتي ويهدون بغير هدي تعرف منهم وتنكر قلت هل بعد ذلك الخير من شر قال نعم دعاة على أبواب جهنم من أطاعهم قذفوه فيها قال قلت يا رسول الله صفهم لنا قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نعم قوم من جلدتنا ويتكلمون بألسنتنا قلت فما تأمرني إن أدركني ذلك قال تلزم جماعة المسلمين وإمامهم فقلت فإن لم يكن لهم جماعة ولا إمام قال فاعتزل تلك الفرق كلها ولو أن تعض على أصل شجرة حتى يدركك الموت وأنت على ذلك متفق عليه وهذا لفظ مسلم. الفائدة الأولى أولا حذيفة بن اليمان رضي الله تعالى عنهما هو حذيفة ابن حسن وحسن ينتهي نسبه أبوه إلى عدنان وسمي باليمان لأنه حالف أهل اليمن وهم الأنصار حالف أهل اليمن وهم الأنصار وأمه رباب حالف الأنصار بني عبد الأشهل وأمه رباب أيضا الأشهلية قد أسلمت وبايعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حذيفة ابن اليمان هو يعني هو وأبوه وأمه من الصحابة كذلك إخوته رضي الله تعالى عنهم جميعا.
The hadith is upon the authority of حذيفة بن اليمان. May Allah be pleased with them all. He said that this hadith, which was reported by Imam al-Bukhari, a Muslim, and this articulation of the hadith is for Imam Muslim. Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, may Allah be pleased with him. He said, people used to ask the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the good things, but I used to ask him about the matters in which are bad, because I was afraid that they might overtake me or catch up with me. I said, O Messenger of Allah, we were lost in ignorance, meaning before Islam, meaning the pre-Islamic era, ignorance and evil. Then Allah brought to us this good, meaning this religion of Islam. He said, will some evil come after this good? He said, yes. I then asked, will there be some good that will come after that evil? He said, yes, but that will be tainted. That good will be tainted with some evil or corruption. He said, I asked, how will it be tainted? The Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there will be some people who will lead others on a path different from mine, and on a way different than my way, in my sunnah. You will see good from them and bad. I asked, meaning Hudhayfa, he said, I asked, will some evil come after that good? He said, some people will be standing and calling at the gates of hell. Whoever responds to their call, they will throw him into that hellfire. He said, I said, O Messenger of Allah, describe them to us. I mean, who are these callers to the hellfire? He said, there will be from our own people, and it will speak with our own tongue or our own language. I asked, what do you advise me to do if I should live to see that? He said, stick to the main body, community, meaning the jama'ah of the Muslims, and their leader, meaning their imam. I asked, what if there was no main body, and there was no leader? He said, isolate or seclude yourself from all these sects, all those deviant sects and people. Even if you were to bite onto the root of a tree or a bark of a tree until death overcomes you, and you are in that state. Here in this hadith is a great many benefits. Here Shaykh Abu Abdullah Rahman al-Maisani, he mentions the first benefit, or the first from the points in which we wanted to mention pertaining to this hadith, is here this hadith was upon the authority of Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman. He is Hudhayfa ibn Hasal and his father, in which he had a truce or a treaty with the people of Yemen. Hence the name Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman. However, his father's name is Hasal. And because of his treaty and his pact with the people of Yemen, he was given that name. And he is from the Ansar, Bani Abd al-Ashhal. The tribe, the people that he had a pact with were the Ansar who lived in Yemen, in which they were from the people, the family or the clan of Abd al-Ashhal. His mother, I mean Hudhayfa's mother, her name is Al-Abab. And she was from this clan, in this household. She was al-Ashhaliyya, or she was from this tribe of Abd al-Ashhal. So he and his father and his mother and his siblings were all believers and from the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
الوقفة الثانية مع هذا الحديث هي في قول حذيفة رضي الله عنه كان الناس يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يدركني. ينبغي على الإنسان أن يعرف الشر من الخير، لكن الأهم منه أن يكون أو أن تكون معرفته للشر حتى لا تدركه ولا يدركه الشر. ليست كما يقال ثقافة معرفة يكون عنده لهذا الشر دون أن يكون الأمر عنده مخافة أن يدركه، مخافة أن يدركني. كما قيل عرفت الشر لا للشر ولكن لتوقيه. ومن لا يعرف الخير والشر من الخير يقع فيه. والصحابة رضي الله عنهم كما ذكر حذيفة كانوا يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير أو كان الناس وكنت أسأله مخافة أن يدركني. إذا نستفيد أن معرفة الشر ليس لذات الشر، وإنما مخافة أن يدرك هذا الشر هذا العبد فيرديه. نعم.
The second matter, the second point of interest and point of benefit of the hadith in which we want to mention from the hadith of Hudhayfa is where he said, may Allah be pleased with him, and I used to ask the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the bad things out of fear. I was afraid that they might overtake me, catch up with me. And here, the Muslim should be upon this, meaning like he wants to know the means in which will get him into Jannah, he also needs to know the matters in which will keep him away from the hellfire. He needs to know the good, and he also needs to know the bad. However, why should an individual know this and learn it? Not because, as they say, he wants to attain different sciences or know different subject matters and topics, just to be generally informed. However, he learns it so he can stay away from it and beware and be cautious of it. And as it was said, we know, or I got to know, or got to learn evil, not for evil itself, however, to stay away from it. Whoever doesn't know evil will fall victim to it. And so, it is not knowing the evil and corruption for itself, however, for an individual to stay away from it.
أيضا نستفيد من قول حذيفة رضي الله عنه كان الناس يسألون الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يريد بذلك الصحابة، يريد بذلك الصحابة. ويفهم من هذا أن المرجع للصحابة هو النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فينبغي أن يكون المرجع لجميع الناس في أمر دينهم، في أمر معرفة الخير والشر، هم ورثة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهم أهل العلم الذين يقومون في كل مقام من تعليم الدين مقام النبوة، مقام النبوة في تعليم الناس. فلا ينبغي أن يسأل عن الشر وعن الخير وعن معرفتهما إلا أهل العلم، هم أعلم الناس بالخير والشر في كل زمان ومكان. وكما قال سبحانه وتعالى فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.
The third matter is in his statements, may Allah be pleased with him, where he said, and the people used to ask the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the good things, but I used to ask them about the bad things, out of fear that they might overtake me or catch up with me. Here, we learn from this as well, is that the people he's talking about, that they used to ask the Messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the good things, are the Sahaba, the companions of the Messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we learn from this that the companions, they used to go back to and refer their matters back to the Messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, acquire their knowledge from the Messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was the source of the knowledge in which is to be taken and learned from. Likewise, in regards to our case and those who came after, companions and those who follow upon righteousness in the day of judgment, it is incumbent upon us all to turn back to our learned ones, our scholars, the knowledgeable individuals in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who inherited that knowledge from the Messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For they are the most knowledgeable in the affairs of the people. They are the most knowledgeable in regards to the affairs of the people and in the religion of Allah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do so, where he says in what it means, and ask the people of knowledge, ask the people of the dhikr, meaning the Qur'an, the knowledge, if you know not.
أيضا نستفيد من قوله رضي الله تعالى عن مخافة أن يدركني. ماذا نستفيد؟ مخافة أن يدركني. ماذا نستفيد منها؟ نستفيد أنه مهما بلغت من العلم ينبغي أن تخاف من الفتن. فحذيفة أمين سر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعالم من علماء الصحابة، ويكفيه شرفا أنه من أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ومن السابقين بإحسان، مع ذلك يخاف على نفسه، والله سبحانه وتعالى قال في محكم تنزيله: ولمن خاف مقام ربه جنتان. قال أيضا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما في الحديث القدسي، قال الله تعالى: وعزتي وجلالي لا أجمع لعبدي بين خوفين وأمنين. فمن خافني في الدنيا أمنته في الآخرة، من خافني في الدنيا أمنته في الآخرة، ومن أمنني في الدنيا أخفته في الآخرة. فالخوف من علامات الإيمان، من علامات الإيمان الخوف من الفتن. يقول عبد الله بن أبي مليكة رحمه الله تعالى وهو أحد التابعين: أدركت 30 من أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم رضي الله تعالى عنهم، كل يخاف على نفسه النفاق، يخاف على نفسه النفاق. ينبغي أن نخاف على أنفسنا، ولا تغتر بما قرأت، لا تغتر بمن تعلمت تحت من، لا تغتر في أي وقت أنت، لا تغتر في أي مكان أنت. فإن الفتن لا يخاف منها إلا المؤمن. جاء عند الإمام البخاري حديث صحيح أن المؤمن إذا رأى الفتنة قال: هذه مهلكتي، هذه مهلكتي، فإذا أنجاه الله منها وأقبلت الأخرى قال: هذه. ما يغتر بنجاته من الأولى، إنما يخاف على نفسه دائما الفتن. ومن أدعية النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلبي على دينك.
The fourth matter in which an individual is to benefit from is the statement, or the part of the statement, where Hudhayfa, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, out of fear that I was afraid that it might overtake me, meaning this bad or this thing that I used to ask the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about, or that I asked him about, out of fear that it might overtake me or catch up with me. We learn from this is that whatever level you have reached in your deen, in your religion, in knowledge, that an individual should always be afraid. Always be afraid from trials and tribulations, from the calamities, the matters in which taint his religion. Here, Hudhayfa ibn Yaman, may Allah be pleased with them all. It is enough that he is a companion of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now he was from those who were in the forefront, who embraced Islam, and from those who sacrificed themselves for this religion, and who knew so much pertaining to it. With all of that being said, and also him being the one who knew the secret of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam concealed his secrets to him. And with all that, he didn't say, well, that's enough and that suffices me. However, he still feared for himself that he falls to fitna. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in what it means, and whoever fears in the status of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Lord, he will receive two heavens, two paradises. I mean, he will be rewarded double and multiplied. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the sacred hadith, he says, and he swears, he says, I swear by my honor and my majesty that I will not combine two times of fear for my servant and or two types of security. He says, whoever feels that he is safe from me in this life, I will not allow him to feel that way in the hereafter. And whoever fears me in this life, then I will not allow him to fear me in the hereafter. And so, it is from the signs of one's iman and true faith to fear for himself, especially in the times of fitna and trials and tribulations. It was mentioned, Abdullah ibn Abi Mulaika, and he was from the generation who came after the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said that I caught up to 30 of the sahaba and the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, meaning during their times or during they were still alive, and all of them feared for themselves nifaq and hypocrisy. And he says, so do not be fooled. Do not be fooled with that in which you have already studied or already read or that in which you know or who you are or who you studied under. Do not be fooled by all of that. However, the believer, as it was reported in the hadith sahih, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the true believer is he who when fitna comes to him, it comes upon him, he says, this fitna will destroy me. I will perish because of it. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saves him. And the next fitna comes along, he says, hadhihi hadhi, meaning this is the one. This is the one that will destroy me and I will perish because of it. And so he didn't say, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved me from the first one, or I survived the first one, I'll be able to handle the second one or the third one or whatever the case may be. However, he always feels fears for himself. That's why the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his abundance of dua, he used to say, oh Allah, you are the one who tosses and turns the hearts. Keep my heart steadfast upon your religion.
أيضا نستفيد من قوله مخافة أن يدركني أن الفتن قد تدركك وإن لم تدركها أنت أو تبحث عنها. الفتن قد تأتيك, هي التي تأتي وإن لم تبحث عنها أو تذهب تريدها. الكلام هنا على من أدركته, وأما استشراف الفتن فهو أمر محرم ولا يجوز لك أن تستشرف الفتن. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من استشرف لها استشرفت له, وبين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما ينبغي على العبد أن يفعله من ذلك أنه إذا أقبلت عليه الفتنة وهو قائم, جاء في الحديث الصحيح أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال تدرككم الفتن فالماشي فالجالس خير من القائم والقائم خير من الساعي. فلذلك أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, لذلك ينبغي أن نأخذ من هذا فائدة, وهي أنه لا يجوز الاستشراف والبحث عن الفتن كما يفعل بعض الناس اليوم من البحث عن الفتن وإيقاظها قراءة فيها ثم بعد ذلك الوقوع فيها دون الرجوع إلى أهل العلم, ثم يقع كما يقال الفأس في الرأس بعد فوات الأوان.
The fifth of the points in which, or the benefits that were shared to us by Shaykh Abi Abdullah Rahman Umayy Salam, may Allah preserve him, he says, still mentioning the part where Hudayf ibn Yaman, may Allah be pleased with them all, he says, and what it means, or he says, where he's in regards to when he's asking the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about those bad things out of fear that they might overtake him or catch up with him, he says, that fitna might not overwhelm you. We learn from this that fitna might not overwhelm you, or they might not overtake you, or they might even come to you, even if you're not the one who was looking for them, even if you're the one who doesn't want to be involved in them. However, trials and tribulations might come to an individual regardless. And here, the speech is in regards to that matter, meaning if fitna was to come to him and he is to be overwhelmed by them, what to do in that situation. As for the one who goes to them and he is the one who was initiating the fitna, starting it and welcoming it, this of course is impermissible in our religion and is prohibited. The Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us in the hadith that whoever welcomes a fitna, welcomes it with open arms and goes to it, it will overtake him and do away with him and drown him in its evil and corruption, or that in which he meant. Also, the hadith in which the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, meaning in the times of fitna, in the times of trials and tribulations, the one who is sitting is better than he who is standing, meaning in this fitna. And the person who is standing, he's better than he who is walking. And the one who is walking is better than he was running, meaning in this fitna. And so, unfortunately, you will find a lot of people in this day and age, except for those who Allah bestowed His mercy upon, they fall to this. They fall under the opposite of the category which was mentioned by the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You will find them running, hastening, rushing into this fitna, into the trials and tribulations and calamities and matters of misguidance. And he enters into it with no way out. Or when he seeks a way out after that, it is too late. For as they say, the ball has dropped. Or for lack of finding a better parable for the statement. It is too late, and he will find himself that he has drowned in that fitna, and it overtakes and overwhelms him.
مخافة أن يدركني قال فقال يا رسول الله إنا كنا في جاهلية وشر فجاءنا الله بهذا الخير. وهنا وقفتان. الوقفة الأولى الاعتراف، الاعتراف بالخلل والنقص وما كان عليه الإنسان من النقص قبل وجود التمام. هذا من الأمور التي تجعل الإنسان متمسكا أكثر من غيره. يقول عمر رضي الله عنه تنقض عرى الإسلام عروة عروة إذا وجد في الإسلام أو نشأ في الإسلام من لا يعرف الجاهلية. الذي يعرف ما كان عليه من الضياع، من البعد، من النقص، من الهوان والذل لغير الله سبحانه وتعالى، تجد أنه إذا تمسك تمسك بوضوح وتمسك بقوة. قال إنا كنا في جاهلية، ما قال كنا أذكياء، كن عندنا شجاعة، كان عندنا كذا، لا، كنا في جاهلية وشر. والوقفة الثانية قال فجاءنا الله بهذا الخير، الاعتراف لله عز وجل هو المنعم وحده، وهو الذي يجلب الخير سبحانه لا شريك له. كل خير هو من الله، وما بكم من نعمة فمن الله. فالاعتراف لله عز وجل بأنه هو المنعم بكل خير، هذا من توفيق الله عز وجل للعبد. فجاءنا الله، وانتبهوا ما قال فجئتنا، وانظروا إلى توحيد الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم، فجاءنا الله بهذا الخير. انظروا كيف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعلق أصحابه بالله، ما يعلق أصحابه به. قالوا ما شئت، قال ما شاء، ما شاء الله وشئت. قال جعلت لله ندا، قل ما شاء الله وحده، ما يعلقهم به سبحانه صلى الله عليه وسلم. قالوا يا رسول الله اعطنا، قال إنما أنا قاسم والله هو المعطي، رواه البخاري. إنما أنا قاسم، أنا الذي أقسم بينكم، لكن الله هو المعطي. والآن تجد هؤلاء، كثير من هؤلاء متصوفة وغيرهم من أهل البدع، يربطون الناس بهم ولا يربطون الناس بشرع الله، يجعلون الناس يتعصبون لأنفسهم ولا يجعلون الناس يعرفون الحق، يجعلون الناس ينتصرون لرأيهم ولا يجعلون الناس ينتصرون لكلام الله وكلام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The sixth benefit from the hadith shared to us is here where Hudhayfah, may Allah be pleased with him, where he says, O Messenger of Allah, we were lost in ignorance, meaning in the time of pre-Islamic, in the pre-Islamic era, we were lost in the abyss of ignorance, of darkness and evil, and corruption. Then he said, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought us this good, meaning he brought us this religion of Islam. Here, there are two matters that we want to mention, and two things that we benefit from this fragment of the statement. First and foremost, Hudhayfah, may Allah be pleased with him, and all the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, confessed how short they were in regards to their shortcomings, how deficient they were, how ignorant and lost they were before Islam, before this state of perfection came into existence, and before this legislation came to be. And here, you'll find a lot of times those who embrace this religion of Islam or come to the Sunnah and are very zealous and determined pertaining to it, most of the time, or most likely, it is from those individuals who were on the opposite side of that and who realized, suffered, and went through trials and tribulations, and were from those who lived in that time of, or lived in darkness and in corruption and evil. And so they know the amount of blessing that they have when they reach Islam, or they reach and live the Sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why it was reported that Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that Islam, or the bonds of Islam, will be broken or nullified bond by bond or strand by strand if there are those, meaning in this religion, are people who don't know the matters of the pre-Islamic era or the matters of kufr and disbelief and so forth. And so, Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman, may Allah be pleased with them both, he said, or he didn't say that we were in honor before Islam, we were brave, we were courageous, we were this or we were that. He said, and he acknowledged and confessed to the fact that they were deficient. and they were in ignorance and in darkness. The second point, or the second matter, is the acknowledgement that this came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, recognizing that all of this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This tawheed, this true monotheism, and believing that there's nothing that takes place except it is from the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His decree, and that He is the one that bestows the favor upon people. He is the cherisher, sustainer. He's the only one that chooses and guides who He wills, and so forth. And here he didn't say, meaning Hudayb ibn Yaman, he didn't say, "Oh Messenger of Allah, you brought us this good." He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave us that good. Allah brought this good, meaning Islam.
مع أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هو الذي جاء بهذا الخير من الله عز وجل.
When the Messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he is the one who spoke from that in which he heard, was revealed to by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was the one chosen by Allah. However, the Messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم used to always refer the matters back to Allah. And the companions likewise, when they understood this true aqidah, this true sound creed and methodology of tawheed, they also understood it as well. From the examples of this is that man who said to the Messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, "Whatever Allah wills and you will, O Messenger of Allah," he said, "Have you made me a counter equal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Say whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills and that's it." Meaning whatever Allah wills alone. And so, even when those who came to the Messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and said to him, "O Messenger of Allah, give us, provide for us," he said, "I am just one who divides the provision among the people and shares it with the people. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one that gives. And I am just a person who distributes that good and those provisions. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one that provides it." And here, unfortunately, you will find a lot of times, those, an example of those extreme Sufis and so forth, those who want the people to turn to them and turn to human beings. Or not only that, even those who are dead. And they want the people to cling their hearts and connect their hearts to these dead individuals or to those individuals who are alive, however, they cannot benefit anything. And they cannot benefit them with anything or deprive them or hold back or save them, secure them from any type of evil. And they want people to turn back to their thoughts and ideas, their opinions and suggestions. However, not to turn back to the words of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
جاء عند الحاكم أنه جاء برجل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقد اقترف معصية فقيل له قال له الصحابة تب إلى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال والله قال هذا الرجل والله لا يتوب إلا إلى الله فماذا قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عرف الحق لأهله عرف الحق لأهله كذلك الأعرابي الذي دخل والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على المنبر قال يا رسول الله ادعو الله لنا ما قال يا رسول الله أغثنا وإنما يا رسول الله ادعو الله لنا علم أصحابه التوحيد وأنشأهم ورباهم عليه ينبغي على كل داعية إلى الله عز وجل أن يربي الناس على توحيد الله عز وجل يربي الناس على عدم الالتفات إلا إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى.
Likewise, that in which was reported by Al-Hakim, that a man was brought to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this man had committed a sin or an evil. And so they said to him, "Repent to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." He said, "I swear by Allah, I will not repent only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." So the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, this individual has recognized he who deserves that repentance and knew that individual has recognized truly who to turn to, meaning to seek that repentance and seek that forgiveness. And truly who deserves that. Also likewise the companions in which came to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam while he was giving a sermon, he was giving a khutbah, and he said, "O Messenger of Allah, call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us," meaning from this drought that we are suffering from. He did not come and say, "O Messenger of Allah, save us. O Messenger of Allah, bestow your favor upon us." Likewise, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you should teach the companions teach them this tawheed, this true monotheism. He brought them up that way. He brought them up and raised them that way and taught them and educated them that way. And so it is upon every da'i, everyone who calls to Islam, everyone calls to this true faith, everyone who is calling to this true religion and only way of salvation, that he follows in those footsteps, teach the people true monotheism and teach the people tawheed.
أيضا نستفيد وهذه فائدة لا أستطيع أن أتجاوزها أيضا نستفيد من قول حذيفة رضي الله عنه إنا كنا في جاهلية وشر فجاءنا الله بهذا الخير وخاصة ونحن في بلاد كفار وكذلك هناك من كان كافرا فأسلم أن هذا خطاب له ولجميع المسلمين أن من كان في جاهلية فأمامه الطريق مفتوح أن يصيب هذا الخير الذي جاء من عند الله سبحانه وتعالى بل ويرتفع به إلى الدرجات العلى الصحابة كان الصحابة كثير منهم قبل الإسلام في الشرك في أخبث أنواع المعاصي ثم بعد ذلك حفظهم الله بهذا الدين ورحمهم به ورفعهم به فلذلك لا تنظر إلى حالك قبل أن تسلم أو قبل أن تهتدي وانظر إلى أمامك وأن لعل هذا الخير تصيبه وترتفع به ويكون هذا لك مؤنسا ولذلك الفضيل بن عياض رحمه الله ذكر في ترجمته أنه كان من قطاع الطريق والذهبي لما جاء إلى ترجمته قال وكان في أول أمره شاطرا للطريق أي قاطعا للطريق قال ثم تاب الله عليه ورفعه قال ولا عجب فقد تاب الصحابة من الشرك فغفر الله لهم ورفع شأنهم كذلك أنت وأنا الجميع كنا في من الأخطاء وكنا في الزلل كنا كذلك من من كان في الكفر ثم هداه الله عز وجل فأمامه أن يرتقي وأن يعمل بما فعل الصحابة بما عمل الصحابة رضي الله عنهم يقتفي أفعالهم وأثارهم وكما قال الحسن البصري إن كنتم على آثارهم ستصل إليهم.
Also from the seventh benefit which here was shared to us by Sheikh Abi Abdullah Rahman Al-Maisan, may Allah preserve him, in regards to where the statement was mentioned that the people used to live in ignorance. They were lost and evil. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought this good, meaning this Islam, especially when we are living amongst the kuffar, among the non-believers, disbelievers and polytheists, atheists and so forth. And there is a lot of us, maybe, or some of us, who used to be a non-believer and then embraced Islam. And so this is addressed to the likes of those men and or women. And it's addressed to all of us and is a reminder. And a matter that which we should ponder and reflect over is that this status in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates us with and that He can elevate an individual to the highest of high, like the Sahaba and the companions, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised them and elevated their status, even though as some of them or some of them used to, and before Islam, used to worship idols, pray to statues, and so forth. And so this is a reminder for us, and we can keep this in our conscience, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors who He wills, and chooses, and guides who He wills to the straight path. And here it was mentioned, as it was mentioned, that Fudayl ibn Iyad, may Allah have mercy upon him, he was from those individuals who used to cut people off on their path, or for the lack of finding a better translation, he was a highway robber. And as it was mentioned, that some of the Salaf also used to be like this. And then, as it was mentioned in history, in the Seerah, And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave them, or they repented and asked forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he elevated their status. And he said, and this is not something that is considered unimaginable or unthought of for the Sahaba and the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, used to worship other than Allah, the Exalted and High. And so, there's no doubt, there's not one of us, except that he did whatever it is that he did before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to the straight path, before even maybe he became Muslim, or before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to the sunnah, or the proper aqidah and true manhaj and true understanding of the religion. And so, this hidayah and this guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Exalted and High. And as it was mentioned by Al-Hasan al-Basri, that he said, and if you follow their footsteps, meaning the companions and the righteous predecessors and those who follow upon righteousness of the Day of Judgment, you will reach the goal, even if that might take you some time.
ثم قال حذيفة رضي الله عنه بعد أن قال إن كنا في جاهلية وشر فجاءنا الله بهذا الخير فهل بعد هذا الخير من شر؟ قال نعم، أي أن الخير الذي جاء به النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والخير الذي في أول هذه الأزمنة هو الخير الذي أمرنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالاقتداء به، كما جاء حديث صحيح عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في بيان أفضل هذه الأمة، جاء في الحديث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال خير الناس قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. فهذا الخير الذي كان في القرن الأول هو الخير الذي أمرنا بالاقتداء به والاقتفاء به، فلا خير إلا ما كان موافقا لهذا الخير الذي كان في الزمن الأول، وهو المبني على الهداية من الكتاب ومن السنة. ثم بعد ذلك قال فهل بعد ذلك الشر من خير؟ قال نعم وفيه دخل.
The eighth point of benefit here was mentioned by Shaykh Abdullah al-Rahman al-Maysan, may Allah preserve him, where he says, where Hudhayfa asked the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and will some good come after that evil? Or where he says, where he asked the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, excuse me, will some evil come after this good? The Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes. He said, then I asked, and will some good come after that evil? He, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, yes, but it will be tainted with some evil. Here, this part, that good in which was mentioned by the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the evil will come after it, we have to understand, that good that was meant was the good of the time of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The best and greatest era, the best and greatest generation ever to live and walk the face of this earth after the prophets and the messengers. They are the ones who should be followed and should be taken as role models. They are the ones who the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam clarified to us and illustrated that they are the best people, as he says in the hadith, and which translates and what it means, the best of the people are my era and generation. Then the ones after them, then the ones after them. So, the good that was mentioned here, that first good that was mentioned, was meant by it, is the good in which all Muslims need to follow, and all need to follow in their footsteps. And that there is no good except that good in which was established by them.
كما جاء في الحديث أيضا عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن هذه أمتكم جعل أو نعم جعل عافيتها في أولها وسيصيب آخرها بلاء وفتن يرقق بعضها بعضا.
As was mentioned in the hadith, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, likewise, where he says and what it means, this nation of yours, its safety, security is in its beginners, meaning the beginning of those in the beginning of the religion, or in the first of those who embraced this religion and followed it and established it. And the end of this nation will be a people, unfortunately, that will be afflicted with trials and tribulations.
ثم بعد ذلك أيضا المسائل المستفادة من قوله رضي الله تعالى عنه هل بعد هذا الخير من شر؟ قال نعم. هل بعد هذا الشر من خير؟ قال نعم. فيه فائدة وهي أن الشر والخير يتعالجان ويتصارعان إلى قيام الساعة. بعض الناس يقول كيف نستطيع أن ننهي الصراع بين الشر والخير؟ هذا لا يكون أبدا، لأن هذه حكمة الله سبحانه وتعالى، وهو أحكم الحاكمين في خلقه، أن جعل الخير والشر يتصارعان. وإنما الصحيح أن تسأل فتقول ما هو المخرج؟ كيف نستطيع أن نخرج بالمسلمين إلى سبيل النجاة وإلى طريق الأمان؟ هذا هو الصحيح. أما السؤال كيف نستطيع أن ننهي الصراع، هذا لا يكون أبدا، أن هذا الله عز وجل جعل الصراع حتى يميز الله عز وجل ويميز الله عز وجل بين الخبيث والطيب. فإذا علمت يا عبد الله أن الصراع موجود بين الخير والشر، تعرف الخير وتتمسك به، تعرف الشر تحذره، فإن النجاة بمعرفة الخير والتمسك به، والنجاة بمعرفة الشر والهروب منه والخوف من الوقوع فيه.
The ninth benefit that is deduced from this hadith is here where Hudhayfa, may Allah be pleased with him and his father and all the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, O Messenger of Allah, we were lost in ignorance and jahiliyyah and evil, then Allah brought us this good. Will some evil come after this good? He said, yes. And then I asked, will some good come after that evil? He said, yes, but it will be tainted with some evil. This part of the hadith, we learn from it that there's always a constant struggle between good and bad, between piety and righteousness and corruption and evil until the end of days. Till the end of days. We find sometimes individuals mistakenly say, when will this end? When will this struggle end? And will it ever come to an end? It will never come to an end. However, your question should be, how can one be saved? How can one survive the times of trials and tribulations and calamities? How can one be saved with his religion and attain the highest of heavens? And so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not allow this matter of struggle between good and bad until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala distinguishes between the good and the bad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala passes judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees what He wills.
ثم قال بعد ذلك، ولعلنا نقف عند هذه الفائدة، ثم بعد ذلك يكون تتمة حديث وقت آخر في محاضرة أخرى، قال وهل بعد هذا الخير وهل بعد هذا الشر من خير؟ قال نعم، وفيه دخن، وفيه دخن. هذه مما يؤكد، أو هذا مما يؤكد على أن الخير عندما يعود في آخر الزمان على الناس لا يعود كأوله، لا يعود كزمن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، يكون فيه غبش ويكون فيه دخن ويكون فيه عدم وضوح لجميع الناس إلا لبعضهم، ومن أوضح الله عز وجل له السبيل والطريق. قال نعم، وفيه دخن. وهذه الكلمة هي مبينة وموضحة لما هو، أو ما هو نعم للشيء الذي يكون في آخر الزمن وفي آخر الوقت، وأن هذا الدخن لا يؤثر عليه من حيث هو، وإنما يؤثر عليه من حيث الناس وعدم رؤية الناس له. فالقمر قد يكون واضحا جليا ناصعا، ولكن تكون الغمام أو الدخان فيؤثر على الرؤية إليه، لا يؤثر عليه، يؤثر في الرؤية إليه لا يؤثر عليه. ونسأل الله عز وجل بمنه وكرمه وإحسانه أن يجعلنا وإياكم من المهتدين بهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، كما نسأله سبحانه وتعالى أن يقينا الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن. اللهم إنا نسألك بأنك أنت الله الذي لا إله إلا أنت، نسألك يا أرحم الراحمين أن ترحمنا وأن تتب علينا وأن تغفر لنا ذنوبنا وأن تجنبنا مضلات الفتن وأن تحفظنا وذرياتنا من الشيطان وذريته. والله أعلم، صلى الله وسلم وبارك وأنعم على نبي محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. ولولا يعني الإطالة لأخذنا هذا الحديث بفوائده، ثم أيضا أعتذر أني ما حضرت لهذا يعني الحديث كما يعني ينبغي، فهذه أشياء لعلها يعني هكذا علقت في الذهن، وينبغي على يعني من أراد التوسع في معرفة شرح الأحاديث الرجوع إلى كتب شروح الأحاديث المعروفة التي اعتنت بكلام السلف وكلام العلماء. وجزاكم الله خيرا. أيضا أشكر بعد شكر الله عز وجل الإخوة الذين كانوا سببا في هذه المحاضرة، الإدارة ذلك الشيخ علي فقه الله، سامعين جميعا. وأشكر أيضا مترجمي الخاص شيخ اسماعيل زال الله خير حتى ما يزال علينا لأنه ما شكر من الإخوة الإدارة.
الله يستر.
فإن شاء الله بإذن الله يتبعونه شكر بعدين. بارك الله فيكم جميعا.
The tenth benefit and the last and then which we will mention in this class or segment and lecture is the statement of Hudhayfa, may Allah be pleased with him, when he kept on asking the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or he asked him, and will some good come after that evil? Where he, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, yes, but it will be tainted. That good that will come after that evil will come. I mean, there will be good, however, it will be tainted with some evil. And this part of the hadith allows us to understand, or is deduced from it, that the good that was meant, that will come after those trials, after that tribulation, after all that bad that takes place, Even though it is good, it is not like the good that came in the beginning. It is not like that first original good or goodness in the time of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba. The religion is not the same. Meaning, with that clarity and purity and soundness and authenticity and understanding. Also, we learn that it will not be the same after that. And however, it will be tainted. And it will not be clear in this religion as it was, and people will not be established upon this religion as it was, except for a selected few or a very minimal amount. Those who are not bothered by that taint, by that smog, by that confusion, by those clouds in which tainted that air of goodness. And this word clarifies to us that at that time, meaning the end of days, in which will come, or the times after the times of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions, or even though they were blessed with good, however, that good was tainted with evil and corruption, falsehood and sin, and or newly invented matters in the religion. It is not because the religion is tainted, however, their understanding of it is, or their foresight and insight and understanding of the religion is. Just like, for example, like the moon, or take the moon as an example. The moon is clear. The moon glows. The moon's lights. The moon is apparent, and it can be seen from everywhere. However, when there's clouds, it is not because the clouds are bothering the moon, but they come between your vision of the moon and the moon itself. And it comes in the way, and it taints and obscures your vision of the moon. But not because the moon is tainted itself, however, it is because your lack of seeing it properly. And so, here, Shaykh Abu Abdullah Rahman Umaysan, may Allah preserve him. He asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us new from those who are guided upon the straight guidance and path. We ask Allah the Exalted and High to guide us anew to the straight path and keep us steadfast upon it. And he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us anew away from, and may Allah deliver us away from the fitan, the trials and tribulations, then which is apparent and then which is inapparent. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us anew, our families, our loved ones and all the Muslims away from the newly invented matters and the religion, the corruption, the misguidance, of course, away from the shaitan, his whispers. And here he says and he apologizes for if it wasn't that it would be a long time or it would take us a very long time, that we wanted to break down this hadith and share with you all from the points and benefits of it. However, because of the lack of time, and also he says he apologizes because the preparation was not the way he wanted it to be in regards to preparing for this hadith and explaining it. However, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward the Shaykh greatly for that in which he bestowed upon us and shared with us. And he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward all those who allowed us and gave us this ability to partake in this gathering, where he thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost and thanked once again the administration, the congregation, the beloved brothers, the visitors who came to us from wherever it is that they came and thought good in us, and especially Shaykh Ali Hafidhahu Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Imam of the Masjid. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us anew from that in which we heard. Wa barakallahu feekum walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.